be honored by their gift and then to honor them in return.
Is what that
phrase means, love as safety. And the theme for this week is we belong to each other. Now, we could have done the Pat Benatar song this morning, but somehow the words don't quite work for those of you who know, because then it's we belong to the night, we belong to the night. Never mind. At any rate, so what is belonging to each other? What does that mean, to belong to each other? Doesn't that mean community? Isn't that what we think of as community? How many people would translate that into being community, belonging to each other, being part of a community? And that community can be this community, it can be a family, right? It can be a family of choice, it can be the family of origin, it can be a team that we're on. So belonging to each other takes on a lot of different connotations. But is it really community? Is community the highest word, the highest way of describing? By highest, I mean, is that the fullest, the richest, the most dynamic extrapolation of what it means to belong to each other? So I set aside my prejudices for definitions, and I went to my good buddy Webster. We've been pals for a long time. I'm friends with OED too, but he's a little standoffish. Old English dictionary, for those of you who didn't know what I was referring to. At any rate, so Webster says community is a group sharing common characteristics or interests. So we're safe so far, right? We're okay so far. But then it goes on to say, as the second part of the definition. So this is like when you look at food labels and you're looking at the ingredients, this is the second ingredient, which makes it pretty important. Perceiving itself as distinct in some respect from the larger society within which it exists. So why is that such a big deal? Exactly. It's separation, which is the antithesis of what we teach. So, elemental to our philosophy is oneness, unity, that we are all and all is all part of one whole. So to perceive ourselves as distinct from the larger part of society, from the larger society, is counter to what it is that we say we believe, to what it is that we say we live, to what it is that we teach and practice and celebrate. Don't we celebrate oneness? This community celebrates oneness like nobody's business. Every day is all about oneness. So I researched further and found these options. Now, I'm not suggesting that we stop using the word community, because that's what's familiar. That's what we commonly say. I just wanted to offer other words that have definitions, that have meaning, that more closely relate to what it is that we say we believe. So the first, one of my very favorite words in the world, is relationship. Relationship is belonging to each other. Or certainly can be. I'm here to tell you. relationship is so rich. We talked a couple of weeks ago about being pregnant with possibility. Relationship is always pregnant with possibility. Pregnant with possibility to enhance, pregnant with possibility to discover something new, pregnant with possibility that takes us beyond what we have imagined so far. Relationship carries all of that. Would you agree?
Yes.
Oh, good. So next is affinity. Now, affinity makes sense to me because affinity is like, I would rephrase it as like minds. This is a room filled with like-minded people. We share a belief in an idea of life and love and peace and prosperity and the availability of experience that is expansive, that is enhancing, that is uplifting, right?
Yes.
Right.
So, wait, there's more. Because what then crossed my research screen was consanguinity.
Don't you love it?
Consanguinity. And you can all go home and look it up. Consanguinity.
I'd have to spell first.
Okay. consanguinity. Consanguinity. And it is a shared descent from a common ancestor. A shared descent from a common ancestor. So if we are all individuations of the One, are we not that? Do we not share descent from a common ancestor? From a common essence? Now, I'm not suggesting everybody breathe. I'm not suggesting that we change the everyday center of spiritual living to the everyday center of spiritual living of consanguinity. I'm not suggesting that. We could abbreviate it or something. So then, it makes sense that this center would be love as safety. It makes sense that our center would be a place where we could be, receive, give, share, allow that love. And allow that belonging to emerge not only for us, but through us, as us. What a way to grow a center, right?
Right.
As a place of such welcome for that feeling of belonging, a place of such safety, a place of such shared love and shared ideals and shared intention, that there's no mistaking it. Because, you know, lots of people shop spiritual centers or philosophies or gurus. And there are great teachers in every single one. So please do not mishear me. I am not saying don't do that anymore. What I am saying come from that place of such welcome in ourselves, we are able and feel more comfortable with rooting in the place of consanguinity, as well as taking our curiosity, our beliefs, our practice out into the world. It's an invitation. Belonging is an invitation. And this is not a subtle hint about becoming a member. Because believe me, when I do that, it won't be subtle. We are here first and foremost. You know, we think we're here to learn something. We think we're here to share our philosophy. We're here first and foremost for each other. With each other. Because believe me, if that component doesn't work, then we're not here for long. No matter how good the teacher is, or teachers are, no matter how fabulous the music is, no matter how diverse the programs are, if the experience of being together and of belonging with each other isn't working for us, we're out of here. So, my question is, what can each of us do to cultivate an even greater place of welcome in ourselves for the growth, the expansion of this feeling? You thought I was going to save this community, didn't you? That won't be subtle either when I do that. There is so much here that is so rich, that is so incredible. You know, all of you who have been here for the last year and a half, you've heard me say this before, you'll have to listen to me say it again and again because I brag on you all the time. This is a feisty, dynamic, dedicated, committed group of souls who would not make room for anything other than success. Can we applaud them, please? Yes. Whatever it is, we love feeling safe and expressing that, because I know that there are other people in this room besides me who have not always felt that way, have not always felt safe in expressing their opinions, have not always felt safe in expressing their ideas and dreams. Well, welcome, because you have found it. So where do we begin? If we are going to be love as safety, love as welcome, if we are going to be that welcome, if we are presencing ourselves as that welcome, where do we start? Where do we usually start? Right where we are, right? Because what's the word? Is the moment of creation?
Yeah.
Now is the moment of creation. Where were you? Now is the moment of creation. So we start where we are. And we put one idea and one foot and one dollar and one verbal contribution and one showing up in front of the other. That's where we start. That's where we start with everything. Not just the Everyday Center for Spiritual Living. We belong to each other in the world. Universally, we belong to each other, and to make ourselves a place of welcome for that feeling of belonging, that feeling of safety, to show up as that at the grocery store, at the bank, at work, at a singing gig, at wherever we are. That, I assure you, will change lives. That, I promise you, will actually change the world. Rudyard Kipling. Anybody know Rudyard Kipling's poetry at all? Okay, so for those of you who aren't familiar, it's all right, I'm not going to send you on a whole thing where you have to go study Rudyard Kipling. But he was an interesting guy. And it wouldn't surprise me if he and Ernest Holmes didn't hang out together. He wrote this poem in 1926. And the title of the poem is We and They. Father, mother, and me. Sister and auntie say, all the people like us are we, and everyone else is they. And they live over the sea, while we live over the way. But would you believe it? They look upon we as only a sort of they. We eat pork and beef with cow-horn handled knives. They who gobble their rice off a leaf are horrified out of their lives. And they who live up a tree and feast on grubs and clay, isn't it scandalous? Look upon we as simply a disgusting they. We shoot birds with a gun. They stick lions with spears. Their full dress is un. We dress up to our ears. They like their friends for tea. We like our friends to stay. And after all that, they look upon we as an utterly ignorant they. We eat kitcheny food. We have doors that latch. They drink milk or blood under an open thatch. We have doctors to feed. They have wizards to pay. And impudent heathen, they look upon we as quite an impossible they. All good people agree, and all good people would say, all nice people like us are we, and everyone else is they. But if you cross over the sea, over the way. You may end by, think of it, looking on we as only a sort of they. Community or consanguinity, it matters not how we name it. It matters how we are it. We begin, as I said, where we always begin. We take one step at a time. We dress up and show up as a place of welcome for belonging and safety, to be experienced, not just an idea. We become more of who we truly are. We live what we say we believe, which is, we live as life is living through me. Would you please say that with me? We live.